Good morning. This is Dr. Adel Bondok, a professor of anatomy and neuroscience, Mansoura University, Egypt. Today I will talk about the vertebral column and the vertebral canal and its anomalies. Regarding the vertebral column, as you know, it is formed of 33 vertebrae and intervertebral discs. The vertebrae are distributed as 7 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 sacral, and 4 coccygeal vertebrae. The cervical vertebrae are characterized by the presence of a foramen in the transverse process called the foramen transversarium. Thoracic vertebrae are characterized by the presence of costal facets for the articulation with the ribs. Lumbar vertebrae have neither foramen in the transverse process nor costal facets. They have large body. The space between the body and the vertebral arch, this space is called the vertebral canal or spinal canal. The vertebral column is not straight, it is curved. It has two main curves, primary curves and secondary curves. Primary curves are present during the fetal life and at birth. Secondary curves appear after birth. Primary curves are convex posterior. Okay. Secondary curves are convex anterior. Primary curves are present in the thoracic and the pelvic region. Secondary curves are present in the cervical and lumbar region. Therefore, we have four curves: cervical, thoracic, lumbar, and the sacral curve or pelvic curve. The cervical curve is a secondary curve. It appears at the third month when the child raises his head. The thoracic curve is primary curve, is present at birth. The lumbar curve is secondary. It appears at the 9th to the 18th month when the child sits and begins to walk. The pelvic curve appears at birth. It's primary. The cervical curve is convex anterior. The thoracic curve is convex posterior. The lumbar curve is convex anterior. And the pelvic curve is convex posterior. Regarding the intervertebral disc, this is the intervertebral disc. It is formed of two parts. Peripheral part called the annulus fibrosus and is formed of tight collagen fibers which are attached to the bodies of the previous and next vertebrae. So the annulus fibrosus connect the bodies with each other and formed of tight collagen fibers, and the spongy center called the nucleus pulposus, and this nucleus pulposus is formed mainly of water, 80% water, and it absorbs shocks. So the function of the nucleus pulposus is to absorb shocks exerted on the vertebral column, and the nucleus pulposus actually is the remains of the notochord. This is the intervertebral foramina transmitting spinal nerve or nerve roots and radicular arteries. Intervertebral disc shows degenerative changes with age. So age changes in the intervertebral disc can be summarized in the following sequence. The first is decrease in water content, and the disc loses its elasticity. The disc becomes thin leading to bone-on-bone friction and deformation of osteophytes. So the age changes in the intervertebral disc start by decrease in the water content, loss of elasticity, becomes thin, bone-on-bone friction, and osteophyte formation. This is the intervertebral disc, and this is a degenerated intervertebral disc causing disc prolapse of the nucleus pulposus, compressing the spinal cord or cauda equina. This is the nucleus pulposus herniated, okay, compressing the nerve root. Okay, herniated nucleus pulposus or herniated intervertebral disc compressing the nerve root. This is a normal disc, annulus fibrosus and the nucleus pulposus. Then we'll talk about the contents of the vertebral canal or spinal canal. This canal between the buds and the vertebral arch of the vertebrae, it contains number one, this structure, spinal cord, till the disc between L1 and L2. Below L2, cauda equina. This is the cauda equina in the vertebral canal. This is the conus medullaris, the end of the spinal cord, at the disc between L1 and L2. So the vertebral canal or spinal canal contains the spinal cord till L1, L2, cauda equina below L2. Then the three layers of meninges, dura, arachnoid, and pia, and the epidural space. And this epidural space containing internal vertebral venous plexus, this plexus, and epidural fat. Regarding the blood supply of the vertebrae, very similar to the blood supply of the spinal cord. So the vertebrae are supplied by anterior spinal artery from the vertebral artery, posterior spinal arteries from the pica, which is a branch from the vertebral artery. Pica is the posterior inferior cerebellar artery, and radicular arteries. Radicular arteries radiating along the length of the vertebral column arise from in the neck from the vertebral and ascending cervical artery. The ascending cervical artery is a branch from the inferior thyroid artery. In the thorax from the posterior intercostal artery, in the abdomen from the lumbar arteries, and in the pelvis from the lateral and the median sacral arteries. According to the venous drainage of the vertebral column or vertebrae, these are the vertebrae, they drain into the internal vertebral venous plexus, and the internal vertebral venous plexus will drain into the external vertebral venous plexus. Then we'll talk about the abnormalities of the vertebral canal. We have three main abnormalities: spina bifida, vertebral canal stenosis, compressing the spinal cord, and abnormal curvatures or abnormal curves. Spina bifida, we have three types of spina bifida. Spina bifida occulta. Spina bifida with meningeal seal. And spina bifida with meningeal seal. Spina bifida occulta. This is a spina bifida occulta. It is a defect in the vertebral arch with absence of the spine. This defect is covered by skin and a tuft of hair. Spinal cord and the meninges are in place. Usually, spina bifida occulta shows no manifestations. So most patients don't know that they have it. And the commonest site is the lumbosacral region. Xenospina bifida with meningocele. This is meningocele protruding through the defect. Meningocele, and the commonest site is the lumbosacral region. Meningocele protruding through the defect in the vertebral arch. Spina bifida with meningomyelocele, again in the lumbosacral region. Protrusion of the meninges and the nerve roots. This is the myelocele. This is the neural fold, and this is the central canal of the spinal cord opening into the amniotic cavity. Third anomaly is abnormal curves. We have three abnormal curves. This is the first one, kyphosis. And the kyphosis is exaggerated backward curve in the thoracic region. This is the second one, lordosis. It is exaggerated forward curve in the lumbar region. And this is a third abnormal curve, which is scoliosis, abnormal lateral curve. So we have three abnormal curves: kyphosis, lordosis, scoliosis. Regarding kyphosis, this one, this is a normal curve. This is a normal thoracic curve. This is exaggerated thoracic curve. So kyphosis is exaggerated thoracic curve, is exaggerated backward curve in the thoracic region. And the commonest cause is osteoporosis. Second anomaly is lordosis. This is a normal lumbar curve. This is exaggerated lumbar curve, exaggerated forward curve, and it is very common in pregnant women. The third anomaly is this one, exaggerated lateral curve, scoliosis. So scoliosis is exaggerated lateral curve of the vertebral column. Or is actually lateral curve of the vertebral column, because normally the vertebral column doesn't have lateral curve. Okay, so scoliosis is lateral curve of the vertebral column. It is the most common abnormal curvature. It is more common among females. And the cause of this lateral curve is unequal growth of the two sides of the vertebrae. One side, this side, in this case, this side grows faster than this side. So unequal growth of the two sides of the vertebrae. In this case, this side grows faster. In this case, this side grows faster than this one. Thank you very much, and have a nice day.